Good morning, good morning, good morning, Crossing family. How are you doing?
Good morning, Jeff.
Miss Tori.
How are you?
You know what? Listen, the last few minutes have been...
It's been fun.
It has been fun. So for those of you joining us online, those of you over at Midtown, good morning to you. And those of you right now here in the room here in Windmill, good morning. Hello, hello. How are you? Make some noise. There we go. There we go. That's good.
Windmill's awake.
It's good reception. They are awake. They are awake. So I don't know. How do you want to get this thing started? It's another Sunday.
Okay, so last night I was at this party.
Okay.
And we were discussing our vacation plans. It's been like 2 years since I've been at an event
where we
sit and talk about our summer vacation.
Okay, all right. And you're doing what? What are you guys doing? What's the plans?
So the other day I surprised my husband and I booked him a cruise because that's his thing.
Wait, so years, but you're all going on the cruise?
Oh, no, no, no.
He's going by himself.
No, just him and I.
Okay.
maybe he'd like it better if he just went by himself. I'm not sure. But no, we're going together.
Okay, so that's a beautiful thing right there. I want everyone to put in the chat, if you're online with us, joining us on Facebook or over at Midtown or maybe even right here in the room, I'd love to know, cruise or no cruise because of the seasickness. I'd love to know what people think about that. Because sometimes...
Because I do get...
Seasick.
Yeah.
Okay.
Which is one of the reasons I usually push back.
Okay.
But this time, replenishes him. And so
love it. I love it. I love it. Love it. Okay, we are beach people. We're beach people. So I love the beach.
So where are you guys going this summer?
We're doing San Diego.
Yes.
San Diego. It's been a minute, but it's.
Are you going to go to the zoo with the girls?
No, no. We tried that. It was not good.
Not yet.
Not yet. They're just too. They're too young. We've walked and cried and fussed. So it's all good. But we're glad that you're here, Tori. If they are joining us, where should they be going right now?
Oh, for sure you need to go to the What Up.
Got it.
So if you look at the bottom of your screen right there at that QR code, go ahead and take your camera and put it on that QR code. That's going to take you to the What Up, which has everything you're going to need for today's service.
There you go.
And if you did it last week, do it again this week because we update it every week with the playlist, with the message notes, with updated events that you want to register for, be in the know of. Everything you need to know is right there.
Love it. Love it. Because and I think what's interesting about that, what's interesting about that as well is I think you find from message notes to the worship songs, but because we keep it up to speed, sometimes people just say, oh, who cares? No big deal. But then it's like, well, what's going on? What's happening? It's
exactly.
All right there every single week, including we have something called Discover, which is our next step. For those of you that are brand new that are joining us, we do it every Tuesday. We meet online. We'd love to say hello to you, meet some of the pastors, tell you more about the church, the vision of our church, and as far as where we're headed, maybe the things that we value, but also how you can get involved, how you get, and you can get connected. But because you decided to do that, because you decided to join us at Discover, we're actually going to donate $10 on your behalf, all to an organization that we have that we call a partner of the month.
Yes, and this month it is Olive Crest.
Olive Crest, yes, ma'am.
And Olive Crest is an amazing organization here in the Las Vegas Valley. And what they do is they work with children, especially those that are in need of families, like in the foster care system, and they help connect families and community, really just bring life into these kids.
So my wife's going to kill me for saying this, but I'm going to say this out loud. I have this itch for more kids, and we shouldn't. We're three
Come
deep.
On.
We're three deep. And so every time I legitimately think about, like Olive Crest, I every time it comes up here, I consider it. But then she's like, no, not yet. Not yet. Or she says, no, I'm done. What? But kids, man, I love it. I think there's plenty of kids out there, I think, that just need some love. And I think an organization like this, partnering with them, this is why we do what we do on a consistent basis, because it's organizations like that that are making a big difference in the community as a whole. So,
Jeff, which is actually a perfect segue into the next thing, because one of our other partners that we partner with on a regular basis is YWAM. So YWAM is in Mexico, and right now we have a group of like 70 guys who are getting ready to cross the border back into the United States, because they've spent the last 3 days, they left on Thursday, and they have been helping to build homes for people who don't have any. And you know, on Thursday, these people in Mexico, they were living in really dire situations. And today they have a roof over their head.
Yeah.
They have four walls. They have an ability to provide for their families.
It's a change.
It's a it's a game changer. It seriously is.
And so we have that was Pastor Lee. No, it's a men's build. This one
was a men's build.
But
ladies,
here we go.
Come on, who's gonna come with me in October for an all ladies home build? Come on,
there's some.
Yeah.
Oh, well, I'm going to check in over here. Midtown, hello, good morning to you. My name is Jeff. This is Tori. We're going to check in online and see who's on Facebook, but also on our Crossing Online app. And I have Tara. Tara's here. Good morning to you. And we have Vinny. Shout out to you as well. Leslie, Bernie. Glad you're with us this Sunday.
And
what do you got?
Over here on, we on Facebook have Jenny. We have Alfonso, and we've got more and more people logging on. So if you have logged on, be sure to just say hi in the chat. We want to give you a shout out. We want to just welcome you, and we are so glad you're joining us this morning.
Yes, and if you are just joining us, we talked about cruises earlier this morning.
We did.
Because Tori surprised her husband with a cruise, and I think I really want to go on one, but I'm nervous about the seasickness. My wife says no, but I got to try it. I heard there's great deals right now, great deals.
It was an amazing deal. Like, amazing, for sure.
That's what I'm saying. So put in the chat there, cruise or no cruise, or your choice for vacation coming up this summer.
Yeah, where are you going?
Where are you going? Tell us where you're headed, if you're headed anywhere. If it's a staycation right here, I know people who do that. We did that multiple times. Find a hotel on the strip, get a nice little locals deal, maybe hanging out here, going to the beach, going to the woods.
Be a tourist for a day.
Vegas.
Like, you can go to the see where I usually hang out. You can go to the M&M store. You can go to a show. Yep. There's lots of cool things, even as a family.
There's a lot to do there.
Yep.
All right. But if you are just joining us, get to the what up. And Ms. Tori, our what up is what?
The what up is your one-stop shop for everything you're going to need today. You're going to have the playlist of all of the songs that they do today. And, hey, spoiler, we have an original song.
Wait, we're doing one.
We are doing an original song.
Our team?
I believe so.
Okay.
They'll kill me if I got it wrong.
Okay.
But that's okay.
It'll be a good way to go. But if you
we have an original song that they're doing, and I'm really excited about it because I've been listening to it kind of come together, and so.
Is it at the end, the middle, the beginning?
I believe it is right after the message.
Okay. Okay, so they placed it perfectly. So for those of you who like to get up and leave early, today is a reason to stay.
For sure.
For sure. Okay.
For sure. Every week there's a reason to stay.
But yeah, but you know, sometimes it's like, oh, I got to get home because of traffic. Well, no. Stay a while. Have some communion. Enjoy the worship. It's good.
Have some community.
Good stuff. That's good stuff. But if you are brand new as well, get to something we call Discover. Meet some of our pastors. But as far as, our pastors, also our staff. We'll tell you more about our church, more about what we value, ways that you can get involved. And I think, in a season like this, I know summer's coming up. I think sometimes people want to take the foot off the gas and say, I don't want to be here. I don't know what I'm going to be a part of, what I'm going to be doing. There are plenty of ways for you to get to know more about the church, but also connect to the local church. So we're asking you this Sunday, next Tuesday at 7 p.m., we are there. And because you did that, we're going to donate once again to Olive Crest, $10 on your behalf. So,
hey, as a mom of a student here at The Crossing, and for those of you who don't know, Jeff is our next gen pastor.
Thank you.
No problem.
Thank you.
You are
uncomfortable, but okay. Thank you.
Well, the reason I bring that up is because what is going on for our students this summer?
Well, we have summer camp coming up here in just a few moments. A few weeks. So we're June 5th through the 10th. We have that for our students and for our kids team. We have it the 21st through the 25th. So anyone kindergarten all the way through elementary. So if you have no kids that are signed up yet, we encourage you, please get them signed up because we have some spots left there to fill up. We have a certain goal with hope we can hit. I think the team has been working hard. It's at nighttime though. It's more of a VBS style. So it'll be from 5 to 8 p.m.
This is the elementary one, right?
This is the elementary one, yes, ma'am. But the student one is we're headed to Forest Home, California. So I'm excited for that one. It'll be different. To be different
Very
again,
cool.
But it's in the woods. It's doing our thing.
Are we doing anything on Wednesday nights?
Wednesday nights, we have a 6-week summer at TCS, if you will. And so we're on a bit of a break until camp. When we come back from camp, we have a different lineup set up. We'll end with a senior celebration. But throughout the summer on a Wednesday, we're going to be doing things like Dave and Buster's, going to Flippin' Out. We have a park day. We have a dodgeball day. And so every single Wednesday throughout the summer, there'll be something for your student, especially for those of you, maybe we have sons or daughters that are going to be brand new, a little bit uncomfortable. It's designed for community. It's designed to bring a friend, all for them to get acclimated and realize, okay, church people are not weird.
I was just going to say, that's a perfect opportunity to bring your friends and hang out for the summer.
That's great.
That is awesome.
Every single Wednesday.
So glad we're doing that.
More details to come.
Awesome.
But I'll shut up. And we have a lot in store for the next few moments here. But again, get to the What Up. Make sure you download that. But afterwards, we will see you back here, discuss a little message. But for those of you at Midtown, good morning. Glad you're with us. Those of you over here at Windmill, say good morning one more time. Hello, hello, hello.
Come on, Windmill.
There we go.
There we are.
And for the rest of you guys online, we will see you back here soon.
Yep. We'll see you after the service.
Crossing. We come as we are, each of us at a different stage of our spiritual journey. People who are young and old, people of all races. We don't exist for ourselves, but for people who are not here yet. People who haven't been invited, people who haven't been cared for, and people who have walked away from God. We are one church, helping people discover Jesus and the journey. We believe that Jesus is the hope in the midst of a world of darkness, and through his church, the world will find light. So, we have a vision to step out of our comfortable living to reach the searching, the broken, and the hurting. To focus on what really matters, partnering with others to fight against the darkness. Knowing that Jesus wasn't just for a select few, but for all of us. We have a vision to begin each day with purpose and to be the church Jesus called us to be. Knowing that we were made to make a difference. This isn't just a church. This is for everyone.
Good morning, friends. Welcome today. Good to be with you all. Let's put our hands together this morning as we come to sing together. We declare the goodness of God.
Wandering into the night, wanting a place to hide this weary soul. Oh, this bag of bones. Oh, and I try with all my might. But I just can't win the fight. I'm slowly drifting. Oh, vagabond, this is our story. And just when I ran out of road, I met a man I didn't know. He told me that I was not alone. He picked me up. He picked me up. Deny what I've seen. Got no choice but to believe. And my doubts are burning. Oh, like ashes in the wind. So long to my old friends. Burden and bitterness. You can't just keep it moving. No, you ain't welcome here. From now till I walk the streets of gold, I'll sing of how you saved my soul. This wayward son has found his way back home. You picked me up, you turned me around, placed my feet on solid ground. I thank the Master, I thank the Savior, because you healed my heart, changed my name. Forever free, I'm not the
saint. I thank the master. I thank the savior. Yes, I thank God. Oh, yeah. Well, I thank God. We are free indeed. Oh, hey, lost another one. Oh, I am free. I am free. I am free. Oh, hell lost another one. I am free. I am free. Declare together, I am free. Come on. Hell lost another one. Oh, I am free. I am free. Yes. I am free. Hell lost another one. Oh, I am free. Oh, I am free. This is good news. Oh, hell lost another one. I am free. I am free, yes, I am free. Oh, hell lost another one. Oh, I am free. Oh, I am free. Oh, I am free, yes. Hell lost another one. Oh, I am free. Oh, I am free. Oh, I am free. Hell lost another one. I am free. Oh, I am free. Yes, I am free. He picks me up, turns me around. Oh, you set my feet on solid ground. I thank the master. battle. No, you've never lost a battle. And I know, you never will. You sing it, come on. You can do all things. You can do all things. But fail, cause you never lost a battle. This is good news today. Hey, we have the opportunity as part of our worship today to celebrate baptisms. And so why don't you grab a seat and take a look over here.
Well, my name is Chuck Brennan, and I'm a little late to this baptism thing at the age of 54. But I do feel I'm definitely at the right place and the right time today. And I'm excited to be here. I've been attending The Crossing since November 4th of 2018. And prior to that, my wife, Mary, and our family have been longtime members of the church. And not only was that day big for me, but it was a huge day for my son, Jet. The family actually surprised me and brought me to church that day. I had no idea this was happening, but he was getting baptized at The Crossing. So it was a huge day for him and very impactful for me, for my first time being there and then not knowing that Jet was getting baptized. Something clicked that day, and since that point, I made a commitment to myself and the family because I could see that they were genuinely happy that I was there, and it was very impactful. So since that point, I've been to church with them and the family every time that we went at The Crossing and in the summer in Newport Beach at Mariners. So we've made church on Sunday a big thing in our family. When that clicked and with a little nudging from the family and Jet and my wife and Pastor Shane, I'm choosing today to get baptized because I need Jesus as my Lord and Savior. And time flies, and I'm definitely not getting any younger.
Chuck, I just love hearing your story. And I just need to tell you, it's such an honor for me to be a part of this because you and I become friends. And as we talked about that journey of you coming for the first time 4 years ago with your family and then to where you are right now, there is no better honor for me than to have this part with your spiritual journey. And so let me just ask you this all-important question. Do you believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and do you name him as your personal Lord and Savior?
Absolutely.
Amen, brother. Well, because of your confession, I get to baptize you in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit, buried in Christ, raised to walk in brand new life. We got you.
Hello, my name is Matthew Lopez, and I am glad to be here today. I found The Crossing Church because I wanted to be around other like-minded people. I wanted to find a place where, you know, there's people that just have that love in them and that want to be found through Christ. And I was at a crossroads myself, too, in life. And I had to really think on, you know, really contemplate who I want to be and where I want to go in life. So I had to stop and really reflect. And I could go left on the wide path and be lost, or I can go right on the narrow path towards my salvation. I choose the narrow path. And I'm one of God's soldiers. I stand for love. I stand for forgiveness. I stand for hope. I stand for others that can't stand for themselves. I'm choosing to get baptized today because I accept Jesus Christ as my Lord and Savior, and I believe that he died for our sins.
Matthew, I love that. I just love to see what God has done in you and finding a church with that is full of people who aren't perfect, but they love Jesus and have surrendered their lives to Him. And so I want to ask you, do you believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and do you name Him as your personal Lord and Savior?
Yes, I do.
Amen. Well, because of your confession, I baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, buried in Christ, raised to walk in brand new life.
What an amazing testimony. You know, we talk a lot about church. We come on the weekends and it can become such a scheduled thing. And maybe, I know for me, it's easy to forget why we gather sometimes. It just feels like you're supposed to. But we gather because the Spirit of the living God continues to blow afresh through His people. And what we just got to see, baptism, I mean, that is such an expression of worship, saying, take my life and let it be for you. And that's what worship is all about. So we're going to continue to sing together. I want to invite you to stand as we just sing about the living God whose presence is with us now.
Gonna hold you.
Father, we remember that there is life and life abundance that's found in you here and now, and also stepping into eternity. That death could not hold you. The same way that you died and were resurrected, we remember that in baptism, that the old is gone and behold, the new has come. Thank you that you walk with us even now, every step of the way. You're with us. Scripture says you are the good shepherd whose rod and staff protects us. So we have a reason to sing today, because you've called us into your life. You've reconciled all things back to yourself. You take anything that's been broken and you can restore it and give it purpose again. And that gives us hope today, because you've taken our lives and breathed purpose back into it. So thank you for this opportunity we have to gather and to sing and to proclaim your goodness in this place. You've been so good to us. We just pause to remember and to give thanks. And in Jesus' name, God's people said, amen. Amen. Well, hey, welcome to The Crossing today. So glad you're with us. I want you to go ahead and grab a seat this morning.
Well, good morning, Crossing. What an incredible morning we've had already. Like this, just listening to those stories of life change and worshiping along with Ryan and the team. If you're joining us online from wherever you're watching today, as always, we are thrilled to have you with us, and the power of technology that allows us to be one church, even if sometimes we're a church at home, and that's okay, and we're so grateful that you're with us. As we say every week, we have a what up. It's really important that you stay in touch with us, and so that you can know what's going on, and also just have things that you can access during the week that'll be helpful for you as you continue in your journey here at The Crossing. You can download that by hitting the QR code on the screen. Always get it through our app or thecrossinglv.com/whatup. If you're a guest today, we are thrilled that you are with us. We're so happy to have you with us. We'd encourage you on the What Up to make sure that you register as a first step. Let us get to know you a little bit for our virtual Discover Lounge. It happens on Tuesday nights. It's a quick RSVP. It's easy from the comfort of your own home, and you'll be able to interact with some of our team and discover more about what The Crossing is about, what our unique values are, and how you can get connected here. So if you're a guest today, don't even hesitate. Just take time, RSVP for that. And just for doing that, a little incentive, Olive Crest, an amazing organization helping kids here in the Valley. We're giving $10 on your behalf. And everybody this month, in the month of May, who is a part of Discover, we're going to be able to make a nice contribution to help their efforts. Well, last night I got a chance to get home early. We had 70 plus dudes, guys, that were in Mexico over the last 48 hours. I probably still have paint somewhere, so if you're in the front or you're zooming in online, just ignore that. But guys, I gotta tell you something. We found out this week that we believe, as far as they can tell, that nearly 100 families over the last 15 years have received homes because of the efforts of The Crossing, both financially and physically being there. You guys, you would have been so proud of this team. They're on their way back, crossing the border, and just their interaction with the family. We had a single mom in the family that I was building for with a teenage daughter who has never had a home. And so they have separate little rooms with beds that they slept in last night because of the fact that we are committed to really making a difference in our world. We believe that's the gospel, that the gospel isn't just about you and I, though it's important, the transformation obviously that God can do in us, but that transformation should lead to us being a reflection of that in others. So thank you for praying. Thank you for your generosity in helping make this a reality. And you can join with us in all of our efforts. If you're here in the room and you wanna give the old school way, I guess is appropriate now, we have boxes at all the exits. If you wanna give physically, you can do that. But whether online or in the room, we encourage you to be a part of regular giving here at The Crossing through the electronic means that we make available to you. It's gonna be a fantastic, fantastic experience for us to continue to have an impact in doing that. Well, we're continuing our Quest 52 series this week. We hope that you're still tracking with us as we're reading along together, doing our devotions on a regular daily basis, and we're going to continue to unpack as Shane talks today about Jesus and how he cares about our relationships. And so you're going to want to lean in on the what up. You can follow along with the notes and the scriptures that he's going to be referencing. So here we go. Thanks so much for joining with us and being with us today.
Well, hey, everybody, welcome to The Crossing. You have picked a great day to be here. Also, I want to welcome all of you who are joining us at Midtown right now and online. Can we just give them a great big hand? So glad that you're part of The Crossing family with us. Well, we are 3 weeks away from kicking off our At the Movies summer series. Now, this is one of our favorite series around here where we use movies as the illustration to teach God's Word. And we have four fantastic movies that we're doing. And as always, we don't tell you ahead of time what movies that we're playing, but I thought I would give you a little hint for our very first movie. It's a retro movie. I don't want to tell you what the title is, but we're going to just kind of celebrate going, you know, back to the movies. And the future is very good, you know, where we are headed. So I'm excited about that one. Then on Father's Day, we have a movie that guys are going to love, but there is something in it for everybody, than two other great movies. But here's the deal, as always, because of copyright limitations, we can't stream these online. So if you want to be a part of At the Movies with us, you have to be on one of our campuses, either here at Windmill or at Midtown. Now, if you're online, I'm going to continue our 52 series through those 4 weeks so that you don't get behind. And so for those of you who come, you can double dip. You can get the At the Movies on Sunday, and then during the week, you can keep up with the 52 series. That is going to start on June 12th. It's a great opportunity for you to invite a friend. So just plan to be here and invite a friend to come with you starting June 12th. Well, we are in week 21 of our 52-week pursuit of Jesus, that we're spending this entire year, 52 weeks, pursuing Jesus. And our focus right now is on the power of Jesus. And when you see the power of Jesus, it doesn't matter whether it is Jesus' power over nature, over demons, over disease, over death, it all points to his identity. So to kind of prepare us for today, I just want to just talk to you a little bit about football, because a bunch of you guys are football fans in here. Okay, there's a lot of you. Now, we're in that in-between right now. If you're a football fan, we're in the in-between. We're in between the Super Bowl and the NFL kickoff weekend. Now, to keep us preoccupied, of course, there's NFL draft weekend. There's nonstop speculation of who's going to make it to the Super Bowl this year. But we're in between the Super Bowl and kickoff. Now, if you're a Cowboys fan, you've been in between Super Bowls since 1996. So it's been a long time. Let me just kind of take you back there. Bill Clinton was president, and high-speed internet was on AOL. I mean, it was a long time ago. Long time ago. But we all spend time in the in-between. The in-between is that space between where you are and where you want to be. See, you might be in between graduation and getting your dream job, in between dating and getting married, in between the diagnosis and remission, in between infertility and pregnancy, in between relationships, wondering if you will find another relationship, in between saying goodbye to somebody that you love and being reunited with them one day in heaven. None of us like to be in the in-between. None of us do. But it is at this place that God does some of his best work in us. And so in Mark chapter 5, we have this encounter today where Jesus encounters two people who are in the in-between. We're going to pick this up in Mark chapter 5, beginning in verse 21. It says, when Jesus had again crossed over by boat to the other side of the lake, so he's at the Sea of Galilee, he's gone over to the far side of the Sea of Galilee to Gentile territory. He's cast out a demon and a man, and now he's coming back to, you know, where his home base for, you know, where he lives and the Jewish people live. It says a large crowd gathered around him while he was by the lake. Then one of the synagogue leaders named Jairus came. And when he saw Jesus, he fell at his face. Now, we're introduced to this first character. His name is Jairus, and he is a synagogue leader. That just means that he directed the services and activities at the Jewish synagogue. Now, because of this, he would have been wealthy, respected in the community. So by him coming and
falling at Jesus' feet, he is risking his reputation. He's risking everything. I mean, what are people going to think? What are people going to say? But when you are in the in-between, none of that stuff matters. He pleaded earnestly with him. My little daughter is dying. Please come and put your hands on her so that she will be healed and live. And so Jesus went with them. We don't know what the background is, whether she had been sick for a long time and she just kept getting worse and worse and worse. We don't know whether the night before she took this drastic turn, but he seems to know that if Jesus doesn't come, his daughter is going to die. Says that a large crowd followed and pressed around him. I don't know if you've ever gone to a concert or to a football game where the crowds are so thick, you know, the concert gets out or the game gets out and you're with somebody, and if you don't hold hands, you are going to get separated. Well, that's what's happening here. This word pressed literally means to be compressed on all sides. That this word, this crowd is pressing in on Jesus. And Jairus, he's trying to get Jesus through the crowd before his daughter dies. And this is where we run into character number two. And a woman was there who had been subject to bleeding for 12 years. She had suffered a great deal under the care of many doctors and had spent all she had. Yet instead of getting better, she grew worse. So compare these two. You have Jairus, a synagogue leader, and you have this woman who has been bleeding for 12 years. He leads the synagogue, and she's not allowed in the synagogue. Imagine the suffering of this woman. She suffers physically. She has some type of uterine bleeding that's been going on for 12 years. And she suffers financially. She's gone to all of these different doctors to try to get well. And she has lost all of her money at the hand of these doctors. And she suffers spiritually. The Old Testament is pretty clear about this. That because of her bleeding, she was considered unclean. And not only would she be unclean, but anyone or anything that she touched would become unclean. It says that when she heard about Jesus, she came up behind him in the crowd and touched his clothes because she thought, if I just touch his clothes, I will be healed. Immediately her bleeding stopped, and she felt in her body that she had been freed from her suffering. She gets this crazy idea that she's heard all the rumors about Jesus, and she just thinks, if I can just touch him, if I can get through the crowd and just touch him, I'll be healed. And notice, she's having this conversation with herself. If I just touch his clothes, I will be healed. It says at once Jesus realized that power had gone out from him. Now, doesn't that just make you want to ask 100 questions? I mean, what did that feel like, power going out of him? Did he feel this power going out of him every time he did a miracle? I mean, it just makes you wonder these 100 questions about this. Well, he turned around in the crowd and asked, who touched my clothes? You see the people crowding against you, his disciples answered, and yet you can ask, who touched me? The disciples are like, are you crazy, Jesus? Who touched me? There's 50 people touching you right now. The crowds are crushing against you. We got to get you out of this and get you to Jairus' house. But Jesus knew that something had happened. He felt power leave him. But Jesus kept looking around to see who had done it. Then the woman, knowing what had happened to her, came and fell at his feet. And trembling with fear, she told him the whole truth. I can just imagine how fearful she was, because she knew she wasn't supposed to touch him. She knew that it would make him unclean. She knew that he was on his way to an important man's house, and now she's scared because he stopped. It just says that she told him the whole truth. She told the whole story to him. I've been bleeding for 12 years. Nobody's been able to heal me. I've been in this in-between for 12 years, And I just had this crazy idea. I just started talking to myself that if I could just touch your clothes, I would be healed. He said to her, "Daughter, your faith has healed you. Go in peace and be freed from your suffering." This is the only time that Jesus calls someone daughter. And I love this because Jesus is so tender with her. Because you know there's not a lot of people who've been tender with her. He's so tender with her. So why did he stop on his way to healing Jairus' daughter? Because there was another person who forgot that they were a daughter. And Jesus is thinking, if I don't stop, you may live the rest of your life believing something about yourself that is not true. Well, you can almost feel the anxiety of Jairus at this moment, that he's desperately wanting to get Jesus to his daughter before she dies. And I just wonder if Jesus is trying to increase his faith, because this is how God works. When I see how God works in your life, it increases my faith. When you see how God works in my life, it increases your faith. This is why I just want to be honest with you about my faith journey, because I think it will help your faith journey. And I just think that Jesus knows that when Jairus sees this woman healed, it will help his faith. Well, his worst fears happen as Jesus is talking to this woman. It says, while Jesus was still speaking, some of the people came from the house of Jairus, the synagogue leader. "Your daughter is dead," they said. "Why bother the teacher anymore?" Overhearing what they said, Jesus told him, "Don't be afraid, just believe." He did not let anyone else follow him except Peter, James, and John, the brother of James. Jesus took his inner circle. These are the three guys that he allowed to see more than any of the other disciples. And notice, Jesus is speaking truth to Jairus. Hold on to that thought. Hold on to that thought. It says he took the child's father and mother and the disciples who were with him. I just think Jesus, he wanted this father and mother to see what was about to happen, to increase their faith, because this is their daughter. He wants them to see the power of God in their lives. And he went in where the child was. He took her by the hand and he said to her, "Talitha koum," which means, "Little girl, I say to you, get up." Immediately the girl stood up and began to walk around. She was 12 years old. At this, they were completely astonished. Completely astonished. Well, there's a bunch of similarities in this story. Similarities that we begin to see God weaving these stories together. A woman who's been suffering for 12 years and this little girl who is 12 years old. Jairus begs Jesus to come heal his daughter, and on his way, Jesus stops for this woman and calls her daughter. Neither of these people have anything to offer Jesus. Jairus may be an influential man in his community, but he has nothing to offer Jesus. Same with this woman. She has nothing to offer. It's just a reminder that Jesus stops for people who have nothing to offer. That Jesus cares for people who have nothing to offer. And both of them are in the in-between. This woman has suffered for 12 years. She's been in the in-between for as long as she can remember. For Jairus, the in-between looks different. His in-between is urgent. It's an emergency. And he's trying to get Jesus to his 12-year-old before she dies. So, what do you do when you find yourself in the in-between? What do you do? For some of you, you've been here for as long as you can remember. You've been in the in-between in something in your life you can't even remember when you weren't there. You don't remember what it was like before you were in the in-between, whatever that is for you. Some of you, That's been your reality. You have gone through this up and down roller coaster faith journey in your life because you're still in the in-between and you don't like it. There's others of you who are in the in-between and it's urgent. Something has happened in your life. And you just feel like if God doesn't intervene, I don't know what I'm going to do. That your in-between is something that happens right now. Now, before I talk about what to do in the in-between, I want to talk about what happens if we're not careful. Because the in-between can create room for unhealthy patterns in our life. See, the in-between, it can make room for isolation. It's isolation in our life that... This is one of the results of the pandemic over the past 2 years. While we were forced into isolation at the beginning, this isolation has now become a mental health crisis. That what experts are calling this is they're calling this the loneliness epidemic. Nearly one out of two people, take that in, nearly one out of two people say feelings of loneliness range from intense to unbearable. And this is especially true for teenagers. See, this is why student ministry, it's a big deal to us. The in-between can cause us to isolate ourselves from others. The in-between can also make room for complaint. How many of you know somebody who complains all the time? Okay? How many of you are that person who complains all the time? See, what happens when we allow the in-between to be filled with complaining, we go from complaining about our situation to complaining against God in our situation. That it can just become this thing that just becomes to encapsulate us. The Apostle Paul in Philippians, he says, I have learned to be content in all circumstances, in any and every circumstance. See, if you're not careful, the in-between can be a place that leads to isolation, complaint, and then this third one is what I just call meltdown. See, we all respond to stress and anxiety differently. That we can become so weary living in the in-between that what we do is we just start to give up and we begin to justify bad decisions. We begin to justify why that's okay. We go back to old habits, unhealthy relationships. Maybe it's when you're susceptible to pulling away from God that your life, it just begins to melt down. See, the in-between can create space for isolation and complaining and meltdown. However, if you allow God to be part of the in-between, it can create room for faith. See, this is what Jesus was doing with Jairus. Is he was using that moment to create faith in Jairus. See, you don't always get to choose what happens to you, but you do get to choose how you respond to what happens to you. This is where our faith is formed in our life. And so what I want to do is I want to give you a practical next step of what you can do when you find yourself in the in-between. Because we all find ourselves there. You may be there right now. I want to give a practical step that we learn from this woman and that we learn from Jairus. And it's this right here, that you speak truth to yourself. This is it. That you begin to speak truth to yourself. I want to show you again what this woman does as she approaches Jesus. When she heard about Jesus, she came up behind him in the crowd and touched his clothes because she thought, if I just touch his clothes, I will be healed. Well, this word right here, it literally means this. To say, to speak, affirm over, to teach. This is what she's doing right here. That she is teaching herself. She is affirming herself. If I just touch his clothes, I'll be healed. If I just touch his clothes, I'll be healed. And she keeps speaking this truth over and over and over. With Jairus, it's a little bit different. When his friends tell him it's too late that his daughter has died, It is Jesus who speaks truth into him. This is what we read here. It says, Jesus told him, don't be afraid, just believe. Now, here's what's interesting. This word, it's the exact same word. It's the exact same Greek word as that one, to say, to speak, affirm over, to teach. And so, what Jesus is doing is Jesus is speaking truth over him. Jairus, don't be afraid, just believe. Jairus, don't be afraid, just believe. For some of you, you have been in the in-between for so long, you don't know how to speak truth into yourself because the things that you speak into yourself are not truth. So let me just give you a couple steps for speaking truth into yourself, and it may be what you need to begin to tackle if you're going to do this. The first is this, is you have to identify the lie that in the in-between, there are some lies that we tell ourselves. These are the things that we speak into ourselves. I'm never going to get better. I've struggled for too long. My marriage is too broken. My finances are too wrecked. My child's heart is too hard. I'll never find a spouse. I'll never be good enough. See, these are lies that we tell ourselves that are not true, but they impact our relationship with God, and they impact our relationships with other people in our life. For me, one of the lies that I used to tell myself when I got up to speak on Sunday, that this right here, it can tend to be overwhelming pressure. And so what I would just begin to tell myself, well, Shane, you don't have anything good to say. And you know people are going to say, well, you're not deep enough. That wasn't helpful enough. You're not smart enough. You're not a good enough leader. And besides that, if people knew your struggles, they'd be so disappointed in you. And it was in a season in my life where I finally decided, I didn't even know I needed to deal with that. I just knew life was not going well. And I went to Blessing Ranch. It's a counseling center that I've told you about for pastors, and I just spent a week there, and my counselor helped me identify that lie. And to finally be able to identify it and call it out for what it was. And so now, the truth that I tell myself, Shane, you're a child of God. You are a child of God. You do the work, you leave the outcomes up to God. You do all you can do, and then you let God do what only He can do. Here's how the Apostle Paul talks about this. The Apostle Paul says, we take captive every thought to make it obedient to Christ. Now catch this, that we take our thoughts captive, and we take those thoughts captive, and we make them obey Jesus. This literally means that we steal back those lies, we steal back those thoughts, and we bring them under the submission of Jesus. So that's what we do. You have to identify the lie. And then here's the second part of this. It's to replace the lie with God's truth. If we're going to speak truth to ourselves, we have to identify whatever lie we've been teaching to ourselves and replace it with God's truth. See, it's not enough to just identify the lie. You have to replace it with God's truth. We capture that thought. We capture that lie. We make it obedient to Jesus. This is what happened with the woman in our story. She had been told for 12 years that she was unclean, unwanted, unworthy, and Jesus comes along and He calls her daughter. That's God's truth. That's God's truth. So what would change for you if you really believe that you are God's daughter? If you really believe that you are God's son? What would change for you if you really believed that you are a child of God? See, you replace whatever lie you have told yourself with God's truth. So how do you do that? You go, okay, that's great, Shane. How do you do that? You need to be in God's word. This is why I would encourage you to be in your Bible every day. It's the way I start my day. It doesn't have to be long. You know, for me, I just use the YouVersion app. And the YouVersion app, they have a verse of the day. Maybe that's what you can do. You can read one verse. Now, I read a chapter a day. It's just what I do. You put God's word into you. And here's the second part of this is you memorize scripture. Because memorizing verses in the Bible, it is the most effective way to speak God's truth into your heart. And so I put these scriptures to memory. So when those lies come up, I can just quote God's scripture. I can just speak truth to myself with God's scripture. I can say what God thinks, what God feels, how God begins to speak truth into me. So let me just ask you, where do you need to speak truth to yourself? Where do you need to start speaking truth into yourself? See, there are some lies that you believed about yourself, and some of them are lies that other people told you. Some of them are lies that you've told yourself. Where do you need to speak truth into yourself? If there's something that you've been telling yourself, but God's word says something different about you, then you are wrong. And I hear people say this, yeah, but Shane, I'm like, there's no but about it, that God's word speaks differently. If there is something that you have believed, but God's word says something different, then you go with God's word. You always go with God's word. And that's the truth that you speak into yourself. So, let me speak some of God's truth into you. Maybe you find yourself in the in-between and you wonder, has God abandoned me? Does God love me? Is he for me? Is God even know what I'm going through? And in the in-between where you're tempted to lose your faith, here's what God speaks into you. 2 Corinthians 5:17, you are a new creation. The old has gone, the new life has come. Your past is the past. When you came to Christ, you're a new creation. Ephesians 2:10, you are God's handiwork, created to do good works in him. You're God's masterpiece. That's who you are. Matthew 7, Jesus promises, listen to this, because some of you need to hear this. Jesus promises that God has good gifts in store for you. He has good gifts in store for you. Romans 8:31, God is for you, not against you. God is for you, not against you. Philippians 1:6, God began a good work in you, and God will bring that work to completion. God will complete that work. It's God's good work. It's not your good work. It's God's good work, and he will bring it into completion. Romans 8:28, in all things, God works for the good of those who love him. Been called according to his purpose in all things, not in some things, not sometimes, in all things, God will take those events that have happened in your life, and he will bring good out of them. It's his promise. Colossians 2:10, that you are complete in Christ. You don't need anything else to complete you. You are complete in Christ. So what truth do you need to speak over yourself today? What's God just saying to you? You're my handiwork. I'm proud of you. I'm for you. I just want to invite you just to bow your heads. We're going to pray. And I just want you, as you're praying, just begin to speak God's truth over yourself. What God wants to say to you. God, we come here today and we thank you that Jesus stops for people who have nothing to offer. That Jesus comes and he's involved with us in our life in the in-between. That we are never alone. That we've never been abandoned. That you will never forsake us. So God, would you just breathe life into us today, your truth. God, for those here who have been telling themselves lies for years, God, they're in that in-between, would you speak your truth into them? Would you free them for whatever they have suffered? And we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
If you're in the room today, I'm going to invite you to locate your communion elements. If you're watching from home, we're going to give you just a moment to locate a cracker or some juice. And then I'm going to invite you to stand with me, if you will. And I want to let you know that here's what we're going to do in the remainder of the time we have together. We're going to receive communion together. We'll lead you through it. And then we're going to respond with a reading today. The words will be on the screen, and your part will be very clear. If the people around you aren't tracking, you can help them. But we felt the best response to today was to do this together, this prayerful reading, which really is identifying the truth of what God wants to do in us while also admitting the lies that often intersect in that reality in our lives. But let's begin with the cracker, the bread. Scripture tells us that Jesus took bread, and he broke it, and he blessed it. And at that moment, he was sitting with his closest friends, and he gave each of them a piece. And he said, basically, what I'm handing you is representative of my body, which will, in a short time, be broken for you. And he blessed it, and he said, take and eat. So very prayerfully today, reflecting on the work of Jesus that allows transformation to be poured out in our lives, let's very prayerfully receive the bread together today. And then he took a cup. He said, this cup represents a new covenant. The old covenant, the old relationship you've had is now changing because I'm establishing a new covenant in my blood, which will be poured out for you. And he says, each time you come to this moment and you drink this, you eat the bread and you drink this cup, you're remembering my work of salvation for you. And that's why every week here at The Crossing, we do this. We pause, we stop, and we remember and we reflect. And so today I want to invite you to receive the cup across our campuses, online, wherever you are, remembering his work for us. And now, just pause for a moment, and let's prayerfully read this together. I'll read, and then you'll join with Ryan in responding. It says this, O Eternal One, it would be easier for me to pray if I were of a single mind and a pure heart. And then you respond, come find me, Lord. Be with me exactly as I am. It would be easier if I could be done hiding from myself and from you, even in my prayers. So
come find me, Lord. Be with me exactly as I am.
I am who I am, a mixture of emotions and excuses, a blur of memories and a quiver of hope. Sometimes I'm a knot of fear, I'm a tangle of confusion, and I'm restless with love, for love. So,
come find me, Lord. Be with me exactly as I am. Yes, come find me, Lord. Be with me exactly as I am. Help me find me, Lord. Help me accept just what I am. So I can begin. So I can begin to be your.
And so I wander somewhere between gratitude and grievance, wonder and routine. I wander between high resolve and and sometimes undone dreams, generous impulses, and then the unpaid bills that I have. So come
find me, Lord. Be with me exactly as I am.
And so help me find me, Lord. Help me accept what I am so that I can be yours.
So come find me, Lord. Be with me exactly as I am.
Make of me something young enough to question, old enough to forget, foolish enough to act for peace, while skeptical enough to doubt the sufficiency of anything but you, and attentive enough to listen. So come
find me, Lord. Be with me exactly as I am.
And as you call me out, all of us, out of the tomb of often my timidity, into the glory of my possibilities, and into the power of your presence, our prayer is, come
find me, Lord.
Be with me exactly as I am.
So come find me, Lord. Be with me exactly as I am. Oh, help me find me, Lord. Help me accept just what I am. So I can begin. So I can begin to be yours. So come find me, Lord. Be with me exactly as I am. Oh, help me find me, Lord. Help me accept just what I am. So I can begin. So I can begin to be yours.
Our prayer is this week that you will find him in fresh and new ways. Be encouraged. Go in peace. We'll see you next week. God bless.
Well, thank you so much for being with us today. That was just such a powerful message from Shane, and just a great reminder for all of us that, you know, God created us for a purpose and for a reason. And, you know, when we get stuck in seeing ourselves the way the world sees us, we're always going to be lacking, right? But when we come and we see how God has created us and we surrender to that, you know, what God can do is just so much more powerful. So don't forget this week that there are so many things going on. Check the What Up. Right there is the QR code. Make sure that you are in tune to, you know, the student activities that are going on. There's registrations happening. There's Discover on Tuesday, so be sure to go ahead and sign up for that if you are new. And make sure to just be with God this weekend. Get into 52, read the next chapter, and have a wonderful week. We are so glad you spent your morning with us. Have a wonderful week.